Check, test, test, check.
Good morning and welcome to church. Just a few announcements. Oh, I left them over here. Hang on. Few announcements. Next Sunday, you'll note, is Super Bowl Sunday, obviously. So we're going to do Super Bowl Sunday as well. We're going to collect change for the Dorothy Day food pantry. So there'll be kettles that will be passed around for you to throw your change in, and we'll make all the donations to the Dorothy Day food pantry. So bring your coins with when you're there. And then Heartbeat went out, and you'll see there's lots of stuff going on for Lent. Our Lenten services actually start next Wednesday. During the season of Lent, we will have services at 11:30, a brief service, and then soup and bread and whatever afterwards. And then we will also do the Lenten service at 6 o'clock on Wednesday nights as well. So if you want the Lenten service, it's 11:30 on Wednesday or 6 o'clock on Wednesday night. And then Sunday morning church will be just normal Sunday morning church. So hopefully that makes sense. And then we're going to do a Bible study on this same sermon series, and that will be on Thursdays at 11 after starting next Thursday. And just bring your lunch with. We'll have a sandwich or whatever you pack with for your lunch and do the Bible study together for that as well. So I hope you'll consider joining me for that on Thursdays at 11. Is there somebody here that was going to speak about the cookbooks? I was thinking they told me they were going to have somebody here. Okay, maybe not. They are for sale already. Cookbooks are $20 a piece. If you pre-ordered, they're in. So stop by the office after church and you can pick up your cookbooks. Otherwise, pick them up at $20 a piece. They're lots of fun stuff. It was funny Wednesday night. People were picking them up and just sitting in the hallway just looking through the recipes. So it was kind of fun to see everybody getting into them. Any announcements that anybody else would like to share before we begin? I've moved the quilt squares out here. They're right out front, so if you want to grab quilts to sew together, those are out there, so please grab one and get those together as well. We'll continue with our service with the invocation. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, by whose hand we were given new birth, by whose speaking we are given new life. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Remember your covenant, renew your creation, restore us that we might proclaim your good news to all. Amen. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near, and by the authority of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved. Amen. Our gathering song, Praise to the Lord, the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb who was slain, Together, let us say the prayer of the day. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our readings for the morning.
Morning. Our first reading today is about the time when the Hebrews have been captive and they're about to be released so that they can go and rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. And they were pretty beaten down, and sometimes we feel kind of the same way. Isaiah gives us images in the reading today about God looking down on us like we look down on insects, and references Genesis on how he took a void and he took and stretched out and made the heavens out of absolutely nothing. He reminds us that he watches us from above, that we are very important to him, enough to give us strength when we need it. And God continues from Genesis till today to give us his creative power if we believe in him and we follow him. So his strength comes to us. Isaiah 40, 21 to 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out the host and the numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on the wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Today's psalm goes on to talk about the exiles of Israel being, again, feeling like they've been forgotten, and how God takes them like a parent and builds them up and gathers them together and tries to heal them, just as you have a child who would come in and has a scrape. The psalmist reminds us that take our mind off ourselves and put it instead onto God. In fact, in the psalm today, it talks about how to worship God, how to sing to God, and how he loves people who are thankful and worship him. Please read responsibly Psalm 147, 1 through 11 and 20. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God, for he is gracious and a song of praise is fitting. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our God and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He gives to the animals their food and to the young ravens when they cry. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. Today's second reading is from 1 Corinthians 9, where Paul explains that we must sometimes set aside our personal preferences to teach the gospel of grace and to serve others. 9:16 through 23. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe betide me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation, I may make the gospel free of charge so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that I might by any means save some. I do all for the sake of the gospel, so that I might share in its blessings. Word of God, word of life.
Our Holy Gospel comes to us this morning according to Mark 1, verses 29 through 39. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by hand and lifted her up, and then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunrise, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was very dark still, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I invite the kids to come forward.
Check, test, test. Come on up. We're doing better today. We're not quite so scared as last week. Perfect. Just come sit right here. You don't have to sit super close. There you go. So, do you know what these are? Batteries, right. Do you put batteries in some of your toys? Yeah. What happens with batteries, though? Do they last forever?
They can die.
You what? They can die. Yes, they can die. Yes, batteries can die. Sometimes they wear out, don't they? Right? We go through a lot of batteries at the church. In my microphone, there's batteries. There's batteries and everything. So we bought these new batteries that charge. They recharge so we can use them over and over and over again. Pretty cool, huh? Yeah? Well, guess what? We can run out of energy too, can't we? Are there times where you get really, really tired? Yeah, me too. Really tired after a long, busy day, right? At daycare and stuff, yeah? So what can we do to recharge? We can pray. We can pray to God and talk to God, and then he recharges us and reminds us all the wonderful things that we get in our life. So how we recharge is by praying to God, okay? Should we try it? Let's fold our hands, bow our heads, close our eyes. Here we go. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us a chance to talk to you, to help have you help us fill our minds and our hearts with a reminder of how much you love us and you care for us. In your loving name we pray, Lord. Amen. Okay, I got this fruit snacks in my pocket. Okay, one for you. One for you. Yep. Should we do Grandma and Grandpa too? Or do you want to share with Mom? Let Mom eat them both? Yeah, there you go. All right, go back.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. If you ask someone right now, how are you? Most often they will tell you how they are, but rather how busy they are. That will be what their response is. Oh, I'm so busy. We all tend to be exhausted with our constant busyness of our lives, our commitments, and our schedules, right? All of us have had times when we feel like we have more to be done than we can manage, like our day or our week is just too short. Joe Marie and I often say, I wish there were more hours in the day. Sometimes we feel like others have more control over our own time. And maybe you're one of those that has a hard time saying no. That's, of course, a bad one for me. It's true, many of us have far more work than we could ever achieve in the time that we have, whether it's at home or at work or school. There are always others who have expectations of us and may try to control our time. We've got emails, we've got text messages, social media, and yes, that occasional phone call that we still get, and we're all expected to be answered and dealt with as soon as possible. It's hard because no one ever wants to disappoint others, but we also can't allow the crazy busyness to rule our lives either. We have to have our own goals and priorities in how our life is and should be. And others shouldn't be allowed to pull us from those plans, but how do we do that exactly? Well, most often for me, I have the urgent matters that I have to deal with as soon as possible, and that sometimes or usually pushes the goals and the plans to the side, leaving those to be considered things I can do over the course of time. That's normal. It's natural to deal with the things in the now and take care of them first. But unfortunately, those things are rarely the most important ones. They're just the most urgent ones. And we find ourselves never really getting any closer to our goals in our lives because of it. Don't feel alone. That's what Jesus was feeling pretty much too in our passage that day. He was in the same dilemma that we often face, prioritizing and not wanting to disappoint others or ourselves. We pick up our story from last week. It's Saturday morning, and let me remind you, Jesus is still teaching and preaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. And as we learned last week, he had driven out evil spirits while he was there. Honestly, believe it or not, what he had been doing really wasn't that unique. You see, there had been many others before him teaching scriptures like he was doing. Some, too, that had driven out evil spirits from those possessed. But so why was Jesus' actions different? What was because he did so with authority. We talked about that a bit last week. What he was doing seemed quite radical to them. He didn't have some big fancy ritual magic trick to perform in order to drive those demons away like the other Jewish exorcists did. They would use their bells and whistles to create a spectacle as they did their work. No, Jesus had authority and simply just spoke a word and the evil spirits obeyed. When I think of this idea of speaking with authority, I think back to when I was a child. When I was younger, my dad traveled a lot during the week. And even when he wasn't traveling, he worked, and my mom stayed home with us and took care of us. I remember my mom always saying when we were not listening or if we were misbehaving, wait until your father gets home. Right? You've heard it too? Or you've said it too? And boy, that meant a lot back then. My dad would come into the house with that authoritative voice, and we would just all fall in line. Well, at least we would when we were little. Teenage years were a bit different, but we're not going to talk about those. You can maybe remember having someone in your life, a parent or a grandparent, maybe a coach or a mentor, that just by how they spoke to you, you knew what was expected and what could and should be done. They had authority in their voice. Jesus leaves the synagogue and heads to his friend's house, Andrew and Simon Peter, for the Sabbath meal. And when he gets there, he's surprised to not see their mother in the kitchen preparing the meal. Rather, he learns that she's fallen deeply ill and she's got a horrible fever. The Sabbath meal is not only not prepared, but the woman is quite ill, and Jesus simply speaks a word. He takes her hand and the woman is healed. The simple words and presence of Jesus has the authority and power all by itself. You can only imagine then that Jesus' authority was going to keep him busy as the word spread of what he was doing. People were coming from far and wide with their sick and their possessed to seek healing, even right over to Andrew and Simon's house that day. What does Jesus do when he sees all of these crowds rushing to see him? What does he do for all those who are looking for miracles? Well, he doesn't lock the door and tell them to go away. Can you imagine looking out and seeing people sick and hurting as far as you can see? No, he's humble. He has a heart full of compassion, and he uses his power to heal and his authority to rid those with demons. He loves all of them, and he does what he needs to ease their suffering as they turn to him in trust and with expectation. He doesn't give anyone a single signal or a sign that he's just had enough of it for now, that he's not concerned about what problems we're dealing with. No, he doesn't push all those coming to see him aside. However, there must definitely had to be a thought in the back of his mind about how pressing his mission is and that his following through with it really is what he was sent here for. But it wasn't going to be easy or hard to complete. Listen again to the last part of our gospel. After Jesus has healed all those that have come, in the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up, went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. And when they found him, they said, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the messages there also, for that is what I have come out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This part makes me feel, as I discussed in the beginning, the feeling of having so much to do with so little time. The feeling of having people trying to control your plan and your time. Jesus gets up early, as it says, it was still very dark, and sneaks away to a deserted place to pray. I'm sure Jesus was trying to find a way to get away from the crowds, but I believe he's also seeking time with the one who sent him. For Jesus, there is one surefire way to seek and connect with his Father, and that is through prayer. Prayer with him helps him refocus, reconnect, recommit, and recharge for the mission ahead. That's not always easy for many to pray. Prayer can take great effort for some, maybe even more effort than they want to give. We can find ourselves having a hard time staying focused, concentrating on God's presence, pushing aside our thoughts about all the other things we could and should be doing while we try to pray. Does that sound familiar? I have that problem many times. I'll start my prayer with God, and the next thing I know, I'm thinking about what I have to get done yet this afternoon. I find my mind wandering in the middle of my talk with God. If we focus our prayer simply on talking to God, we can be better at praying. Make it all about having a conversation with our Lord, just allowing our time, short or long amounts of time, to be with him. We don't know how long Jesus had that day to be alone with his Father. It tells us the disciples were out searching for him, so they must have had some idea where he would be. They instantly remind him that the crowds are again forming around the house, and they're all waiting for him to come back, waiting for Jesus to make his appearance and to continue to heal and save those from demons. But Jesus has a different idea. He says, let's go on to the neighboring towns so I can continue my work. That's what I came out to do. Jesus' time with his Father has reminded him of his mission and that he is here to preach the gospel everywhere, that God has victory over the power of evil and that the kingdom of God is breaking through. It is now that Jesus is preparing the way for what is to come, and he needs to do that everywhere, not just at Andrew and Simon's house. Jesus came to call us individually and as the church, that great commission we know, the sending out of disciples to go and make more disciples, was given in order for us to all be empowered by becoming a part of it, to make that our great priority as well. The world would be conquered by love for God, compassion for our fellow man and women, and that our world would be a place of justice and peace. He wanted us to look beyond the confines of what we know and what we and others try to control to a world of new horizons and a life beyond this material world. Jesus' greatest priority was to connect and reconnect us with God. Proclaim the good news that God's kingdom is at hand. When we say or when we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, your kingdom come, your will be done, that is when we're aligning our priority in life with his great priorities. Let that be our prayer, our desire, our greatest goal in the days and the weeks and the years that are yet to come. I pray you will. Amen. Our hymn of the day and our offering hymn is Blessed Assurance.
Let us pray for the people of God. At the end of each petition, I'll end with God of grace and your responses. Receive our prayer. Let us pray. As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. Everlasting God, you bring your healing power to the church. Give your church a spirit of unity and prayer that we discern your way for us in your world. God of grace, receive our prayer. God, without equal, your steadfast love endures forever. Bring the leaders, elected officials, and peacekeepers of our towns and countries into understanding and unity. Guide them to serve with compassion and understanding. God of grace, God who strengthens, you lift up with your hand any who are suffering. Heal those who are brokenhearted and strengthen the weak and all in need. I ask you be with the family of Jody Berg as she mourns the loss of her dad this week. I ask that you be with Steve Hendrickson as he hopefully gets out of the hospital tomorrow and can get back to his usher duties here at church. And I ask that you be with all of those that we now name silently in our own hearts. God of grace, receive our prayer. God who gives power to the faint, challenge us to share the faith stories of what God has done in our lives. Open us to receive the unique ways God is at work in your people, especially those whose perspectives challenge our own. God of grace, knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Jesus, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us prepare for the meal.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy,
the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body. It was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is the new covenant of my blood. It was given and it was shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered as one, let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At Jesus' table, heaven and earth are joined as one. Come and see. If you are visiting today, there will be gluten-free wafers on the little stand in front of me. The outside rings of the tray are wine, and the inside rings are juice. I do need three helpers today. If you could come forward, that would be wonderful. Joe, can I ask you to go to the piano since I forgot it before? Thank you. Giver of every gift, Christ's body is our food, and we are Christ's body. Raise us to life by your power for the benefit of all, and to your glory now and forever. Amen. Before we do our blessing and our final hymn, we neglected to announce that it was somebody's birthday yesterday, and we're going to have a little party. Linda made cupcakes because it was, look at her getting mad already. It was Esther's birthday yesterday. Raise your hand, Esther, so everybody knows it's you. Yep, right there. She turned 29 and a half. And let's sing happy birthday to Esther.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Esther. Happy birthday to you.
If you didn't know, Esther's the one who always keeps everything so beautiful and decorated out here. So thank her for that, because she always does such a wonderful job to keep us in the spirit of the holidays. Hear this blessing. God who names you, Christ who claims you, and the Holy Spirit who dwells within you, bless you and remain with you always. Amen. Our sending song is O Worship the King. In peace, you are God's beloved. Don't forget your change next Sunday. Have a great week. Amen.